Elizabeth Holmes left Stanford University at the age of 19 to build a company. Now, that same sentence could be spoken about any number of people. But her vision and her success in that endeavor have brought her to us tonight as one of our true revolutionaries. Her company, Theranos, is applying nanotechnology to medical diagnosis. It is achieving extraordinary breakthroughs, and it is changing lives. The most well-known application by Theranos is a tremendously simplified blood test, which you will no doubt discuss tonight. But her larger vision is quite life-changing. It is for a company that uses technology to make actionable health information available to anyone personally at precisely the moment it matters. Since founding Theranos in 2003, she's enlisted some very impressive help. She has one of the most prestigious corporate boards in the country. Former cabinet members George Shultz, Henry Kissinger, former Defense Secretary William Perry, former Senator Sam Nunn. She has a tremendously distinguished group of technologists and pioneers in science on her team. She personally is making every kind of list these days, was on the cover of Fortune in June. This market is valued at about $80 billion, and Theranos, in its 13th year, is now valued at $9 billion. And in her words, it is all about chemistry and technology. With her to lead the conversation tonight is the Dean of Great Conversations on Public Radio, KQED's Michael Krasny. So please join me in welcoming Michael and Elizabeth Holmes.
Well, thank you all for that warm welcome, and let me tell you how pleased I am to be here with Elizabeth Holmes. I've been an admirer from afar, and must tell you that she's a recent recipient of the Horatio Alger Award, which in some ways is appropriate. It's a kind of Horatio Alger story, which I hope I'll be able to flesh out in our conversation. Also, I believe her brother is here, and her mentor, Professor Robertson, is here. Could they maybe just signal where they are? They may come up in the course of conversation as well. So. Just wanted to formally welcome them and welcome you, Elizabeth. Congratulations on the Horatio Alger Award.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here.
Well, let's talk about how you got to be here or where you are. If we go back, I think we have to look at your lineage initially, because your great-grandfather was an inspiration, your parents were inspirations. I mean, this whole vision of yours and making a difference and doing the kinds of things that you're now doing to really revolutionize healthcare. Go back, in a sense, to childhood and to really your genealogy in many ways.
Well, I grew up in a family that was very focused on the belief that we're all here for a reason, and we're here to try to make this world a better place, and that we have a purpose. And for me, I thought I was going to do what my dad did, which was work in disaster relief, because I grew up in a house in which I was surrounded by pictures of him helping people all over the world when really bad things happened. And over time, I started to see business as a vehicle for making a change in the world, because you have total control over what you decide to do and how you decide to do it. Whereas, you know, sometimes people who work in public policy aren't able to fully influence all the things they want to do or the changes they want to see. And so from a pretty early age, I started thinking about that path.
Well, I'll tell you about early age. This is, many of you know I'm a literature professor, and this is a young lady who read the whole of Herman Melville's Moby Dick at the age of 9, which in itself is a pretty colossal feat. So there was something stirring in you even earlier on, and as I understand it, actually I won't get into too much literature because we're both fans of Jane Austen. I said we could do a whole hour just in conversation on Jane Austen.
Yeah, that's good.
But when you went off to school, your dad gave you Marcus Aurelius. This is the last mention, perhaps, of something in the realm of books. But it had an effect. And at that point, I believe you had already started dealing with Chinese universities. You had, as a high school student, you were fluent in Mandarin at that point. All of that kind of, well, call it motivation, because that's really what it is, was really pretty much visiting you at that point.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that focus on a life of purpose struck me very deeply. And everything that we do now and the way we've done it, the way we've built it, has been about that.
You were drawn to medicine, but then I guess you realized as a kid, I'm sorry to tell about your trepidations here, but you were terrified of getting blood drawn.
Still am.
Still yeah. Are, yeah. Okay, and you said, I mean, you've compared it to torture.
Yeah.
You've said that there's nothing else that you're afraid of, really, as much as you are afraid of getting blood drawn.
That is true.
So this all seemed to converge in many ways, really, didn't it?
It did. You know, when I decided to start this company, it was about understanding that laboratory information drives 80% of clinical decisions. Yet we know more about our credit cards than we do about our lab data. And this information is instrumental in being able to see the onset of disease in time for therapy to be effective, because so many of us, when I spent time thinking about, you know, what is the most valuable thing that I could do with my life, to me there was nothing more valuable than being able to change the reality in our world, which is that all too often people we love are lost because you find out too late in the disease progression process to be able to do anything about it. And the fact that making laboratory testing more accessible is a way to help change that, and that as part of that, we can get rid of the big bad needle. That was sort of an added bonus.
Yeah, that's icing on that cake. But yeah. You know, a lot of young people have these dreams, these idealistic dreams, and think, I want to make a difference. I want to do something that will contribute to humanity. But you, as a chemical engineering student, realized to some extent you had to have a patent or two. I mean, that's where it all really began, didn't it?
It did. You have to have, I mean, we believe, you know, here in Silicon Valley, we're a product company, we're a technology company. We believe very much in the ability to help contribute to solving policy issues through technology and through innovation, and this country has seen the benefits of that in terms of its impact economically and otherwise. The patent is a tool for being able to ensure that we do see this technology applied in such a way in which it does make that impact. And so that was one of the first steps in beginning to build our portfolio.
But you had also had some experience, again, in China with working on SARS. Didn't you?
I did, in Singapore.
Yeah. And you had this professor, whom I mentioned before, Professor Robertson, who now is emeritus and now is with your company.
Yes.
And from my understanding, you went to him and you said, I'm ready to work with the PhD candidates, pretty much a freshman. I mean, not with that kind of egocentricity. I didn't mean to suggest that. But you were indeed ready to do that and were pretty much chomping at the bit to get started, so much so that you convinced him. You were obviously convinced and had the conviction inwardly and had the agency, and so you move forward on this. What about dropping out of school, though? I mean, again, you had your parents' support. They were pretty much behind you because they saw how purposeful you were, really.
No, I was very lucky because they could have made that very difficult, but you know, they'd saved their whole life for my brother and I to be able to go to college, and they let me take that money that otherwise would have been used for their retirement to put into starting this company. And
you should mention you were a presidential scholar also, yeah.
Yeah, and I found what I loved. I found what I wanted to spend my life doing. And so there was never sort of a plan to drop out of Stanford, but I was spending all my time doing this, and I
still are.
I still am. I always will be. But I'd learned what I needed to learn to be able to do it, and so that was it.
So the adventure began, and let's talk about. I mean, we want to talk about the company and establishing it and so forth. But before we get there, what about the idea of, because Peter Thiel has been an advocate, as you probably know, in Silicon Valley, one of the founders of PayPal. There's a whole 60 Minutes piece on this of, you know, if you've got a bright idea, an inventive idea, maybe you should not consider a liberal arts education. I mean, I don't think he was necessarily isolating science educations, and you were studying chemical engineering. But what about that idea? Because, you know, Zuckerberg didn't have a college degree, and Bill Gates didn't have a college degree, and Steve Jobs, we keep hearing this. Do you feel that it's advisable for young women who have these kind of dreams, or young men, to give up college if they believe in themselves? Because, you know, you're pretty rare in terms of the success you've had and the mind you have.
You know, I think it depends on why they're considering pursuing whatever it is that they want to pursue and what they really want to do. Yeah, you know, we have phenomenal PhDs and scientists in our company who are changing the world and changing people's lives every day through what they do. And their training and their experience and their research is being applied here in extremely powerful ways. If people want to start a company, you know, the first question that I always ask is why, right? Why a company? Why not, you know, a research project? And I think if people really understand why they're doing it, if there's a mission that they love so much that no matter how hard it is, they want to keep doing it because they found what they love, then absolutely. But sometimes I think people get a little excited about the concept of starting a company, quote unquote. And I think, you know, if that's something you really want to do, then you need to really understand why, because you're going to be able to do a lot better at it.
But you really had the convictions right from the get-go, didn't you? I mean, you not only wanted to start a company, you believed that you could start a company and really have it do the kinds of things that you wanted it to do, this mission of helping people, saving lives.
Yeah. I had the conviction that this is what I want to spend my life doing. And if I had to start a company and fail 1,000 times and start it over again and fail, I would do that. And so when I realized that, then it was about doing whatever it takes to make this a reality, because it's a change that can happen and has to happen in our world.
No regrets about missing homecoming dances and all those kinds of things?
No, although sometimes I wonder if I'm sort of frozen in time from back in those days. But no, I mean, I feel like the luckiest person in the world because I get to live every single day knowing that even in a small way, I've done something that's made someone's life better. And I had the chance to talk to people. I was in Arizona on last Friday and listen to them about what this has meant to them in terms of, you know, cancer patients and what they go through right now and how broken down they are and their families are by just the amount of blood that they have to give, and seeing someone so emotional and knowing that you've changed that. I mean, to me, that's the
wonderful
purpose of life, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And it didn't all start in a garage for you either, like it has for some people.
It started in a basement. Yeah.
Close.
Yeah.
But you've been so devoted to this life of yours and this mission of yours that in many ways, you know, your life is almost, as I read it, ascetic. I mean, monkish or something along those lines, yeah?
I
imagine you with your kale and your, I mean, she's a vegan and all your green concoctions and everything, but just being at that job constantly.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate, yeah. It's, you know, I wasn't always that way, but it's evolved because it's a way to give more and more of yourself to what it is that you love, and this is really hard, and it's really big, and it takes everything, and I've tried to train myself to live in such a way in which I can give my life to it.
Well, that's very noble and admirable. Let's talk about how it started, though. I mean, talk just briefly, give us a sense of how you went out and raised this capital, first of all. I mean, you had people like Larry Ellison and some of the venture capitalists behind you. But also, you know, there was mention of your board, which is an extraordinary board, with some of the most prominent and two former secretaries of state. Actually, George Shultz has had how many secretary cabinet positions?
Four.
Yeah. But, you know, you have this all-star team behind you. And so talk a bit about how those things were engendered. That is, the capital on the one hand and the board on the other.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, when I first started raising money, the question that was often asked when I walked in the room was, what's your exit strategy? And, you know, I'm sitting there kind of thinking about my entry strategy. And so I really tried to find people who had built great companies for the long term and really understood what that meant. And I mean, our tradition, Silicon Valley, the whole venture capital business was started by people who were in it to invest in people who had great ideas and wanted to build great companies for the long term. And so we turned down the first monies that were offered to us. I turned down because I didn't think that they would invest in us for the reasons that I wanted them to. And we were very lucky to end up finding a group of people who had personally been involved in building great companies for the long term and got them involved in this. And likewise, I mean, the board that we have the privilege of having is a group of people who really understand what it means to make a difference in the world and want to do good fundamentally. That's why they're involved in this, because they see it as something that does have the potential to change our healthcare system and apply technology to solving a policy issue which has very profound consequences at a macro level. And so, you know, I've had the chance to get to know these people in different aspects of our work, and we've been able to assemble just a brilliant group from a strategic perspective who can really sit down and think through what's the right way to do this, and how do we make sure we do it in a way that really does realize our mission.
Somebody once said of you, she's like a lot like Steve Jobs, except she's got a much kinder heart. I didn't mean to insult Steve Jobs, but you know, but the fact of the matter is that in some ways he's been a model to you. I know. I mean, even in the black attire. And in many respects, you're trying to do a lot of what he did, but with heart and with a sense of compassion. And it seems to me that what you really have in mind, in many respects, and tell me if I'm wrong, barking up the wrong tree here, but is a whole new concept of preventive medicine.
You know, that's exactly right. I'm a tremendous admirer of what Jobs did. I think he was a genius in the context of his work. I do have to disclose that I've been in black turtlenecks since I was 7.
You were reading Moby Dick and still wearing that? No.
That's thanks to my mother, but I got used to it. I think that this question about preventative medicine is about the individual and it's about the consumer. And there's this incredible opportunity that we have to connect and engage with individuals in such a way in which they can begin to love the products and services that result in changing their lives. And this space, this healthcare space, has not been an area, lab testing particularly, that people love. they do not, you know, leave a lab visit saying, you know, that was awesome, let's do it again. And they should, because it's the first step in beginning to get information that changes their life. And if they begin to understand that they can use this information, I mean, I talk all the time about type 2 diabetes, which drives 20% of United States healthcare costs and is completely reversible through diet and exercise and lifestyle, yet
you're looking at a living example.
There you go. Yeah,
I got the diagnosis. I changed and brought the blood sugar down and everything.
Yeah.
But I had to have those vials by the phlebotomist. You know.
Right. Right. No, exactly. But there's 80 million Americans who are pre-diabetic. 90% of them don't know that they are.
Yeah.
Right. And the point about that is, when people begin to understand that, when you see your lab values and you see the lab values of people who ended up being really, really sick, it's a powerful moment in terms of behavior modification. And that engagement in terms of a product, in terms of a service, in terms of this legacy that we have in Silicon Valley of building great products that people love, is a huge opportunity, because we can create an experience that's wonderful, that people do love. And I think one of the things I'm most proud of with what we've done so far is that we get tons of emails from people saying this was so much fun and they want to go do it again, right? And the more we can change that paradigm, the more we'll realize our mission.
A lot of it, I don't know if the name Tom Ferguson is familiar at all to you, but he was one of the pioneers in self-help medicine and so forth. And a lot of that was geared toward preventive medicine in many ways. But what he never could have conceived of was what you have now with, I mean, isn't a vision to have, like, within a mile or within a few miles, these kind of availabilities of testing? I mean, now you've got the Walmarts, and that in itself, you know, is quite an accomplishment to have.
Walgreens,
but down the line, we're talking global, aren't we?
Well, it has huge implications at a global level, because in so many of these countries, in the same way in which the cell phone infrastructure leapfrogged over the lack of landline infrastructure, there is no equivalent landline infrastructure in terms of traditional testing. And so the opportunity to put a distributed or decentralized testing infrastructure in place is the opportunity to begin building a decentralized care delivery system. And if we can do that, then we can start changing people's lives in a very material way. So it's an extremely important part of our mission. And likewise, in the US, I mean, I've had so many conversations with people who talk just about, for example, driving to the VA, right? The amount of distance that they have to travel to be able to do something like get a blood test done in order to be able to get the care they need is shocking.
Think of what you're doing for the carbon footprint just alone.
Right? Yeah, that's true. And so, you know, this mission is about engagement. It's about access. The tiny samples, a way to engage people in access. The locations are a way to engage people in access. And in the same way, I mean, people should be able to go get their blood tested on a Sunday night without going to an emergency room. And they should be able to do that on a Sunday morning and late at night after work during the week. And so it's all part of engagement.
Well, and the key to the success, I think, on a number of occasions you've said, is inexpensive and transparency. And actually, I sound like I'm promoting you here, which I'm not, because I want to get into some criticism and get your response to it. But there's the notion that that you want to work with the FDA. I mean, you've said this on a number of occasions.
Yeah.
You want regulation. You welcome regulation.
Yeah. We do, and that is seen by some as highly controversial. But the way that I've always looked at it is that we only realize our mission if the information that we generate is actionable. And the information will only be actionable if it's of the highest levels of integrity. And so to ensure that, we've got to do a lot of work and spend a lot of money on a lot of clinical trials. And if we're going to do that, why would we not submit? And that bar, I mean, the reason that we want to work with FDA on this is that it's the greatest stamp of quality that we can get in terms of demonstrating the integrity of what we do. So it's extremely important to us, and we're deeply committed to it. And we're going to do whatever it takes to make sure that we create a model for that.
I want to talk about competition on a couple of different levels. MRIs and other things are moving. I mean, technology is moving forward in a lot of different ways without necessarily taking any blood. And how do you see that, I mean, with your periscope around the corner?
Yeah, the legacy of Silicon Valley is about obsoleting yourself, right?
And, that's right.
And that's something that we spend a lot of time on ourselves, and it's something that's really important to us in terms of how we have organized our company. I think that the potential of laboratory testing in the context of preventative medicine is so transformative, we don't even understand how transformative it is right now. So for example, we've done some work with people at Hopkins who have developed and demonstrated that in blood, you can see the onset of pancreatic cancer 17 years before a tumor forms, right? So you do not want to be figuring out that someone you love has cancer by imaging and seeing a tumor. You want to see it 17 years before it shows up, because that's when you have a shot at doing something about it. And if we can, through blood, through lab testing, make it possible to do that, then we can realize this vision. So we're doubling down right now.
Well, good luck on that score. And when you're talking about pancreatic cancer, it made me think again of Steve Jobs, who unfortunately succumbed to that, a rare form of it. Yeah. But there's also been a lot of concern about the trade secret issue with mm-hmm. respect to your company. I call it your company because it is 50% yours.
It's our company.
Okay. Well, it has your name and your brand on it. It's very humble of you, but you know it has been associated with you, and it will continue to be. I'm just wondering, I mean, with your leadership, but I'm wondering about this sense of secretiveness and all. Yeah. I know you've had some litigation and concern about trade secrets, and any company to get started and get on the move has to be concerned with that. But what about the accusation that things are just too secretive, that you know you should be publishing more in peer-reviewed journals, you should be talking more about your methods of technology, these kinds of things. Ken Aletta, by the way, wrote all about this in the profile of Elizabeth in the New Yorker, but how do you respond to all that? Because it's critical, usually.
We understand that our competition would like us to tell them how we do everything that we do. But, you know, I've always believed, we spent 10 years in stealth mode. We basically had nothing on our website. We never did any interviews, no press. And we did that because we were creating something that has the potential to do what we're talking about right now. And there was no reason for us to talk about it until we'd done it, right? And hyping this up does not serve any purpose. So there's a lot of companies that go out and they publish all this stuff because they're trying to show that they've got the next greatest thing, and that's not relevant for us. We're interested in serving people and serving physicians, and so what's relevant there is FDA and the body called CLIA, which regulates us. And whereas traditional labs are very aggressively fighting FDA regulation and have not ever submitted any of their laboratory developed tests to FDA, we think it's really important. And so we're doing that. And we have, you know, we released our first publication this year, but where we do a publication, in our opinion, it needs to be about something that people publish about. No lab goes out there and does a publication saying my lab test works. The regulators make sure your lab test works. What they do go out and publish is this test, for example, is predictive of this, right? So our first publication was on the ability to do this type of testing in patients who are septic in a hospital. So when you're infected and your bacteria gets into your bloodstream, there's a tremendous need for very rapid measurements to be able to figure out how to administer an antibiotic. And that's what we published around, right? And so we'll keep doing that. But we're going to keep doing that because it serves our mission in some way. And that's what matters to us.
I'm sorry, I just did a program some of the listeners, I mean, members of the audience may know, on superbugs and resistance to antibiotics. We don't necessarily need to go there, but let me go instead to the whole sense of running a business, because there's a lot of problems, obviously, when you have people, you have about 500 people, I believe, now, and you know, there's human error and there's all the difficulty, all the draggy things about doing a business too, you know, deliveries and getting lab people to get the results out and all of those sorts of things. I mean, in many respects, has that been a different kind of challenge for you, and maybe in some ways even more challenging because you mounted this with all of this passion and with all of this commitment and sense of purpose?
Well, we have an extremely long-term mindset, and so we've got over 700 people now, and we've designed our infrastructure differently because we're a technology company. And so in the same way in which we've seen software totally transform traditional businesses like retail, for example, we're able to apply technology exactly to automate much of what was done manually in the past to mitigate human error. And that's the premise around which we're building this company. And that allows us to develop this infrastructure in such a way in which we can also price at incredibly low price points so that testing can become affordable. So we said when we launched this consumer business, for lack of a better word, that we would pursue what the Walgreens CEO calls a crawl, walk, run model. And we've been spending a lot of time in the crawl phase to make sure we really understand how to be excellent in all of those areas, in call center and logistics, because that is absolutely central to being able to realize our mission. And so we're spending a lot of time on it. And we really believe in the power of technology in that context, because fundamentally, if you talk about a clinical analyzer, that architecture has not changed since 1960 when Beckman and Coulter here invented some of the first automated clinical analyzers.
So what do you envision moving along on the trajectory you're on now in terms of the future of your company, of the company? I mean, particularly in the sense of speeding up perhaps the pace. I mean, you're moving so quickly now, but do you want to move it faster? Do you want to move it even less expensive? You said a lot of these prices are incredibly inexpensive, and they are compared to what's paid for Medicare or Medi-Cal or hospital tests and so forth. You want to keep getting, as so many technologists have, the prices even down lower?
Absolutely. We are spending a massive amount of resources. We announced when we started this work, I guess it was just about a year ago, in the consumer and physician space, that we were going to price our tests at less than 50% off of what Medicare and Medicaid are willing to pay. So if they're saying you can send in a bill for $100, we're sending one in for 50, and we've since begun dropping the really important tests down to 90% off of their reimbursement rates, and we think that's fundamental because no person should have to walk away from getting a medical service because they can't afford it, and so we're going to do whatever it takes.
So how does this tie in with the Affordable Care Act?
That's a complicated question. You know,
we just had testimony today from the MIT professor who spoke about the lack of intelligence of the American people. So this is somewhat timely, but yeah, how do you see it connecting? Testimony on the Capitol Hill.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know what that testimony was about. I really believe in...
He said he was stupid. And,
okay.
He was stupid for calling American people stupid.
Yeah, no, I mean, I really believe in the intelligence of the American people. I think that what we need to do in healthcare is empower the American people because they do care. And if you educate them and you give them the tools, I believe they will change in whatever ways they can to help improve their own outcomes. And so the Affordable Care Act, you know, puts additional focus on quality and cost in the ways that it was designed. But fundamentally, irrespective of policy or, you know, whatever systems are in place, people care about saving money. And hospital systems care about it, insurance companies care about it, people care about it, because now even if they're insured, what's happening is their deductibles are increasing at such a rate that they're still having to pay, in the lab testing case, often thousands of dollars out of pocket, even though they have insurance. And so, you know, certainly the system will change because of it, and I think everybody is still trying to understand exactly how, but this work that we do, we're lucky in that it's nonpartisan and it's really policy independent, because these core tenets of cost savings and our mission of getting rid of the need for people to have big needles stuck in their arms holds true in terms of its relevance, irrespective of whatever the policy of the day is, if that makes sense.
It makes sense. And you mentioned the John Hopkins study about 17 years out with pancreatic cancer.
Yeah.
Are there other kinds of things down the line or that you foresee that people would want to know, particularly in terms of diagnostic possibilities that research is showing or leading to?
I mean, I think what's so powerful about it is that people don't really understand it. And because it's been such a controlled thing, they've not engaged in it and used it to try to help make their life better. So I also often talk about the fact that, you know, it's illegal here in California for me to order a lab test that would tell me if I have an allergy to a peanut. And I can go buy a gun and I can kill myself, but I can't order that lab test because, you know, I might stop eating peanuts and that would just be a big problem for society. So, you know, when you talk about a system where until earlier this year, it was also illegal, even if I got my physician to order that lab test for me in many states, for me to get a copy of the results, right, of my own body. I call the doctor's office, say I want a copy, and in a lot of states in this country until there was a policy shift this year, you could not retain your own copy of your own data about your own body. And so I think the first most basic thing there is that when people understand that you can get this information and that it's useful, and also that you can change it. I mean, your example about what you did in the context of your own health is exactly it, because that's how so many of these diseases can help to be managed or reversed. And I think if we can create engagement around that, then, you know, I certainly believe that over time it will become more and more predictive, but it's life-changing, right? Even at this very basic level of the tests that are already out there right now.
Do you have concerns about privacy, though, with respect to personal data, or how do you protect that? How do you particularly create security around that issue?
We're tremendously concerned about it. We put, you know, in all of our documents and materials that we give to the people we serve that we will never sell their data, period. We will never advertise on it, period. And we
heard that from Facebook, I think, too. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. We really strongly believe that individuals own their own health information. And if they tell us that they want it sent somewhere, then we're going to try to make sure every single time that they really want it sent somewhere, until they tell us that they don't want us to keep asking them, that they want to send it wherever they want to send it. And that's the way we've designed our whole system. I think that that's really fundamental in the context of health information, because people don't understand what happens when it gets into the wrong hands and how it's used. And so so creating secure systems and distributed systems that can be designed for the sole purpose of protecting individuals' information and giving them complete control over it and complete transparency over it is really, really core to us.
We'll take questions from the audience, but I'm just wondering if you could perhaps even more illuminatingly, and the conversation so far has been indeed quite enlightening, but talk about what you see ahead for Theranos. I mean, just in terms of presenting this mission, as you call it, to not only a larger scale, because that in itself is pretty formidable, but take us through maybe how you envision the steps to get where you want to get.
I think it's about, fundamentally, it's about ensuring that we do everything so that every person who comes to our locations and who we serve has a wonderful experience and a high integrity experience. And we will scale around that, right? So we can't scale until we know that we've built a system that meets our expectations in terms of what we want to see with respect to quality of service, with respect to providing a wonderful experience for people that changes their whole relationship with getting access to this information, and that realizes the levels of quality that we're holding ourselves to. And if we can do that in one location and we can do it really, really well, then we can do it in another location. And when we've met those standards there, then we can do it in another location. And that's how we think about it. So we've been building a model in Arizona, which allows us to understand the operational elements of this in detail. And we will systematically replicate that. And the next 5 years are about being able to ensure that we can bring that level of service and that level of excellence to every person in this country.
So you have a blueprint.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
There are also what you, I know you've already become a model for so many young people, and particularly young women. What do you say when, especially young girls, ask you, how to chart their lives or how to blueprint their lives, what you've learned from your own experiences that could be valuable, let's say, to young people who want to emulate you?
It is such an important area, and if there is anything that I can do, especially in connecting with little girls about the fact that we should be in science and technology, and it is a cool thing to do, and it's not hard, and you can excel in it in the same way in which you can excel in so many of these other areas. I had a conversation with the CEO of the Girl Scouts, and she was telling me that they took all the valedictorians of their group, and they sat them down in a room, and they said, raise your hand if you think you're gonna be a leader in technology business. And none of them raised their hand. And she said, we were shocked. These girls are valedictorians of their classes. And they spent all this time looking at it. And she said that they didn't have enough role models to be able to see themselves in those positions. And I've always believed that, everywhere there's a glass ceiling, there's an iron lady right underneath it. And the more that we can demonstrate that, I would never have been able to do what I've done in probably any other part of the world, but in this country, you can do this. You can drop out of school as a 19-year-old girl and and create something, you know, that starts with a dream and becomes, you know, a product, becomes a company. And that's how we've built this country. And so being able to communicate that it is possible and that it can be done, you know, I think can't be done enough. And I have the privilege now to start doing that in some schools, and I will do everything that I can to help people see that because it's real, right?
And also to make science and math more accessible for young girls.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I was the only girl in you know, my electrical engineering classes at Stanford and a lot of my chemical engineering classes, and that was not that long ago, you know. So.
What about, and this is not necessarily the most comfortable topic, but I've done programs on this, so I've heard it said over and over again that that Silicon Valley itself is kind of an old boys, young boys club, a kind of fraternity club, that it's misogynistic, that women aren't welcome really as much, that there still are lots of glass ceilings. What do you say to that?
I've never once let myself focus on that. Because it's about the work, it's about the product, it's about the mission. And I've always believed that if we do the right thing in the context of building the company, we'll be successful. And so we've interacted with people from that perspective. And I think that's the only way, because you can create a new reality when you do it that way. And so... So that's how we've approached it.
Well, you've definitely created a new reality, and congratulations on that. And we have a number of people who have questions for you. Let me just go to some of these and bring them in. You could have chosen any path into personal health care. Why a blood test?
Blood test because it plays such a huge role in clinical decision making, right? So 80% of clinical decisions are associated with laboratory data. If you don't have the laboratory data, you're going to have a very difficult time making an effective clinical decision.
Someone wants to know what your biggest obstacle was in starting Theranos. If there is a biggest obstacle, or
there's so many. I started this company assuming that I would fail, you know, thousands of times, and that mindset's very helpful because when something goes wrong, you're expecting it, and you just keep going. So I think the biggest key to success has been getting the right people and finding people who really want to come and have a career in a place where they go because they want to do the greatest work of their life. And you know, when you're able to find those people, everything gets a lot easier.
You talk about how you find those people? I mean, what
yeah.
it is... I mean, I know there's no magic ingredient, and probably a lot of them are drawn to you and your vision, but aside from that.
It's hard. You know, I think we've been so lucky just over the last year to be able to talk publicly about our mission because the people in our company are here for this mission, and it is their mission, and they have seen in their own lives what it means to lose someone you love and what you go through when that happens because you didn't find out in time to be able to do something about it. And so it's very personal. And I think, you know, for us, where we can find those people who are here because this mission is their mission and who are here because they want to grow within this company for the long term. This is not about, you know, hopping around every 2 years to a different company. Those are the right people for us.
When you talk about all your belief in technology and when you talk about saving people's lives and making sure that they live as long as they're supposed to, I'm just curious to know, this may seem a little bit of an offbeat question, but what you think about all this research that Ray Kurzweil and others are doing to keep extending longevity?
I think it's great. I mean, let's make it work. I think that the human body is incredibly powerful, and the more we understand it, the more we can leverage it. I mean, so much of the research that's happening right now, whether it's in cancer or other areas, is about channeling your own immune system to be able to fight some of these diseases. So I think we're just at the beginning of a massive revolution there.
There are some more questions. Somebody in the audience says, it's nice to have the raw data about my own blood, but wouldn't I need a trained medical professional to tell me what it means and what actions to take? Remember 23andMe. I think you've said publicly on a number of occasions you don't mean to shut out the physicians here. They are going to be an important part of your...
They're a critical part, and we've built our whole infrastructure around serving and engaging with physicians. And I think it's really important to separate the legal question of do I have a right to information about my body from what do I do with it, because 40 to 60% of people in our country do not go get their tests done when they're given a requisition by a physician.
Excuse me, Elizabeth, I've seen that figure a number of times. You said 40 to 60, and some dispute it. Some say it's more like 30. Or do you know the source of that?
It's a study by Lewin that was published. But it's also, we've done a ton of research on this, because the people who come into our locations, it come in with years worth of lab requisitions, right? And so we say to them, well, why now, right? And it's because they couldn't afford it. It's because they were terrified of needles and other reasons. So if you can engage people, if you can give them the right to begin getting tested, the way that the physician can provide care is transformed. Because right now, they're often providing that care with people who are not compliant with getting a lab test done. And so, you know, we've built electronic systems and infrastructure to be able to get that data to physicians and to be able to engage people with their physicians. But getting them tested in the first place is the first barrier that we're trying to help get over.
Do you think you may ever partner with a gene sequence company?
I don't know. We'll see.
Time will tell.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to university researchers who have good ideas and potential products on what types of partnerships to seek and steps to take to bring a viable biomedical product to market?
I think it depends on what you're trying to do. I mean, it goes back to if you're thinking about starting a company, why, and what is your motivation for doing that? Because that drives everything in terms of how you structure it and how you build it and who you hire. But if it's about partnering with a company that already exists, then, and for us, it's always about values in terms of, you know, what is this company about? What do they want to do with their products, and how and why? And is that aligned with whatever it is that you've created? Because to me, the purpose of the product is to affect a change or to serve people, right? And so how it's then integrated into a mission is how we think about it.
And how do you inculcate that? Because each corporate enterprise, business, whatever, you know, really does have its own distinct culture. How do you inculcate that in an invigorating way in the people you work with?
Well, I think a lot of it is about the mission, right? And why are people there? In our company,
but you want them to believe in that mission, obviously, and you want them to accept it and embrace it. You
know? Absolutely. I mean, we've structured our business around promoting people from within, right? So, the people who embody our values are the people we promote. And that's been very powerful for us in terms of building that culture, because at any point in time right now, you know, 80% of our headcount is new. So being able to develop an organization in which, you know, the people in leadership positions can do the jobs of their direct reports and embody those values as deeply as I or anybody else does, is what we're working to do in terms of maintaining that culture as we grow.
You've become, at least on paper, very wealthy as a result of this whole enterprise of yours. And I know that must have wrought some changes in your life. It can't help but do that sort of thing. I mean, even there's another Michael Krasny who started CDW Computers, who's a billionaire and one of the richest men in the country, and they had him in Forbes, they had my picture, so I know.
That's great. Sure.
So in my own small way, I've had to deal with this.
How'd that go?
But in your case, I get the feeling, and tell me if I'm completely on the wrong track here, and I'm gonna, you know, say this anyway, because it may be in the wrong track, maybe even been a bit of an impertinent question. I get the feeling that the money isn't even that important to you.
No, and my life actually hasn't changed. I mean, my life is the same. I'm still at the office 7 days a week, and you know, that's what I do. Yeah, I think what's changed has absolutely nothing to do with money. It's that we started talking about this mission just over a year ago, and what that's meant is that we've had the opportunity to connect with people, and that's changed my life profoundly because I've been able to see this applied in ways in which it touches and helps people at a very deep level. And if we can keep doing that and engaging with people, then...
You would do this work even if you were getting modest rewards for it?
I did for 10 years, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, some more questions.
Yeah.
Actually, picking up on what we were talking about before as a role model for young girls, and seeing to it that they're offered more STEM class exposure. What if they're intimidated?
I think that's part of changing the culture, right? And showing that we shouldn't be, because you know, taking a math class can be just as easy as taking an English class. And if we can engage with them at that age and at that level, and help to reshape how we think about it as a society and as a culture, and how we encourage our little girls to pursue those things, we can shift that. And that's the more of us who have that conversation, the more we will shift it. I was so lucky in the way that I was raised that I was never told that I couldn't do something or that I shouldn't do something or that you know it was hard or anything else. And I'm sure that shaped me in a very deep way because I always thought it was possible. And I mean, there's some very interesting studies about this in terms of different groups of people who are brought up with different stereotypes, for lack of a better word, about what they're good at or what they're not good at and how they do in certain testing situations just based on those types of comments being made. And it makes a big impact. So I think if we can start changing that dialogue and start showing that it is possible, I think we'll see that shift.
What about the concern that some have that maybe there's been too much of a shift toward emphasis on STEM at the direct expense of a more liberal education or studying the humanities? I mean, you know, I have students who will come to me and say, you know, why study Melville or Jane Austen when I can learn coding and you know make a living, that sort of thing. What do you say to that?
In my opinion, I think they can't be mutually exclusive. I think the best scientists and the best engineers have tremendous insight into the arts and into history, and I think they're very related. But I think the problem is we have this huge deficiency culturally, especially on the topic of little girls in those areas, and we need to bring that up a little bit. I think if you start doing that at the expense of these other areas, I think that's the wrong thing.
Get to as many questions as I can here from your questions for Elizabeth. Without FDA approval, how do you launch at Walgreens, and how much support or credibility do you have among medicine doctors?
So we're a certified lab, a high-complexity CLIA certified lab, just like all the other labs that provide lab testing, and that means that we get audited on an ongoing basis, and we do what's called proficiency testing, which is where you're sent, for example, 20 blinded samples for every test that you run on an ongoing basis throughout the year, and you have to get the right answer. Otherwise, if you don't, over time, you can lose your license. And that's the laboratory framework today. Our experience in working with the physician community has been to say, try us, right? Test us, use this, let your patients have some experience with it, compare it to the infrastructure that you're using, and that's worked pretty well. And we have a wealth of data. We've been doing this for a long time in the context of building this company, which we engage in with the physicians we serve.
Getting some really good questions here, so thank you to the audience for these. Does Theranos plan to use next-generation sequencing for cancer screening?
I think it's a really interesting question. I think we don't know at this point. We're focused in other areas right now, and more on some of the basic tests. When you think about a cancer patient having to go get their blood count or their white cells measured, on a weekly basis sometimes, that's what we're focused on today. And so we'll see.
Do you think medical businesses such as Kaiser, who have their own internal labs, will be impacted by your technology and business?
Well, an organization like Kaiser is a special bird, if you will, because you've got the integration of the payor functionality with the hospital and practice functionality, and they do have a lab, but Kaiser is a great example, I know, of an organization that cares about quality of care, they care about patient experience, and
they also have one of the best public record data systems in the world, really.
They do, yeah, absolutely. And they care about cost a lot, right? So one of the really important things for us in having those conversations has been about the fact that we don't need to go in and hire every pathologist in the country. We're a technology infrastructure that can be applied to help serve our hospital system and payer partners. And fundamentally, that ends up being very complementary.
More about competition. How would you evaluate the competitors in your sector in general, and naming a few in particular, you may wish to comment on DNA Medicine Institute?
Yeah, we're pretty heads down on what we do, and we know what's gone into doing this, the amount of capital that we've put into this business, and the amount of time that it's taken, and we know we've got an opportunity to really serve people, and so that's what we focus on.
Actually, I've got I almost had a listener here. Well, you are a listener, so. I get up here in these conversations and I almost go on automatic pilot and I say, you can tweet us, you can go to our Facebook page. Have you considered veterinarian medicine? Maybe a great need for patients who cannot talk.
I totally agree with that. Anybody who has watched a little dog or a cat get as much blood taken out of them as a human, understands that. We're trying to serve our talking friends first, but I certainly agree with the need.
And what would you like to see change from a regulatory standpoint?
That's a tough question. Our approach to this has been do whatever it takes to realize the highest level of quality and then go through the regulatory process. The regulatory process here is changing. I think there's a lot of unknown about how that landscape will end up in terms of the integration of FDA into the lab testing space. I think sort of all of our thinking on it is really just about making sure that we do it, and we do it really well, and we put every resource that we can into it so that we ensure we realize the highest levels of quality.
Mm-hmm. One more question from the audience. Are there applications specifically for the developing world?
Yeah, there's tremendous applications, and that goes back to what we were talking about earlier in terms of in terms of the lack of infrastructure in so many of these countries. And when you think about the pursuit of education or economic development in these areas, I've had so much, so many conversations with people who are trying to, for example, pursue education in some of these areas, and you can't really do that successfully if you don't have basic health. But there's no basic health infrastructure. And if we can, through our commitment to doing whatever it takes to drop the price of laboratory testing, make it possible to take incredibly low-cost tests into these areas so that people do have access to it, then we can help to begin building that type of health infrastructure. And we're really committed to that.
Coming near the end of the time that we have, what do you do for fun?
I do Theranos. that's pretty much it.
My curiosity always serves me to at least try to find out a great deal about the people that I have the great privilege of being in conversation with, and I also trust my instincts, having, at this stage of my career, probably interviewed more people than most interviewers. I must say, you are an extraordinary woman, and it's been an amazing young woman, and it's been a real pleasure to share the stage with you, and I want to thank everybody for your attention.
Thank you
for being here.
Thank you. I'm very humbled by that. Thank you.